Welcome to this quick hit episode of the Guns Magazine podcast. I am your host and the editor of Guns Magazine, Brent Wheat. Today, I'm joined by Tom McHale, editor of American Handgunner Magazine, and Roy Huntington, our publisher for both magazines. Hello, Tom and Roy.
Hello there.
Today, we're going to talk about something that is kind of on everybody's mind, the idea of best weapon for home defense. Now, there's lots of discussion about this on the internet, but we felt like we ought to throw our two cents in here. So by virtue of being the host, I'm going to go first. My weapon of choice is the shotgun. Now, people say it's an anachronism. I say I am too, but I still think this is the best weapon for home defense.
What, you can't aim or what?
that's absolutely true. This is a Remington 887. It's the gun that I literally keep under my bed. The only thing I don't like about it, it's got that thing that'll chop your fingers off, and I haven't fixed that yet. But other than that, it's a pretty good weapon for self-defense. I've got mine tricked out. We've got a Streamlight ProTac. Need the light. We've got an EOTech green holographic sight, and I know some people will disparage my choice of an EOTech, but their quality control issues of a few years ago have been fixed. I'm a big fan of these. I've used them in critical situations, so that's what I've got on my home defense gun. Of course, you got to have a sling. You got to have some spare ammo. So if I have to repel boarders at my house, it's the shotgun.
Not okay. Bad. Not bad. You know what? I'll confess, I've one nearby too. So
okay. Yeah. So Roy, what's your choice?
Well, you know, I think it's a no-brainer in my situation here because I have a Desert Eagle 50 A&E, which I mean, to me, it just seems that that's what's most appropriate. Now, I know that it's not a 9mm at any level, and I realize that. But
you're not compensating or anything.
No, but I think it probably could compete at some level. So, no, but seriously, folks, I'm fortunate. I live on 30 acres, and I've got what I like to call a 360-degree free field of fire zone. And so I have rifles and shotguns and all that other stuff. But this is the actual sits next to my bed every day. It's a very early Smith & Wesson M&P 9mm that holds 8 million rounds. It's got a light on the front. Yeah, about 8 million rounds.
Nice.
And no safety. So it's a no-brainer kind of a thing. So if something goes bump in the night or the dog growls, you just get up and wipe the sleep out of your eyes. But, you know, while I got you, something that I want to add into that is that, in all seriousness, is that you need to have a pair of electronic earmuffs sitting right next to your gun. So that way, when you wake up at nighttime, you put those on first, and then you can have Superman hearing, and you can hear the creep, you know, yeah, you can have the creep, you hear the sounds out there. And more importantly is, you need, if you have a wife, you need to make sure she puts a pair on too, because that way you guys can talk to each other. You can hear if, God forbid, you actually do some shooting. So
especially if you're shooting a rifle, which Tom would do. So the entire house, including the bad guy, would be deaf.
And the neighbors and the dogs and the I will officially hand off to Mr. McHale.
Well, I have a two-part system, you know, as my primary. And you know, surprised you guys didn't think of this, but the very first thing, cell phone, no landline.
I hate a smart ass when he thinks he knows everything. Yeah.
I put by my bed. Hey, you like that?
Yeah.
No, but seriously, I think you guys will agree with this. This is a good, I am being a smart ass, but it's a good point.
Yep.
On the charger every night.
And plus you have a emergency backup flashlight.
There you go. And a flashlight. So, but seriously, I'm Roy, I kind of have to agree with you on this whole thing because I choose a handgun too. It's just that mine's bigger. I think you said yours has 8 million rounds. This has 13 trillion. Actually, but seriously, this is a pistol, an AR pistol that I've been working with recently on some projects. And this one is a Springfield Armory Saint Edge. It's kind of their souped up AR pistol. And, lots of reasons I like it. You know, it's still fairly compact. You can carry the thing around with one hand if you need to. But the real benefit of it is a longer gun profile like this is easier to shoot under stress. I mean, you're talking about getting hits on a target, just having that long sight radius, whether or not you have an optic on the thing, much easier to shoot and handle. And the 13 trillion round capacity is not a bad deal either.
You know, Tom, you're right that we did some training where the pistol guys were capping on the long gun guy, saying, "Oh no, somebody will grab your muzzle and you know as you go around a corner. But actually, and anybody at home can try this out, is take a handgun and do an isosceles stance and put it out, and then hold one of these short-barreled rifles up, and actually the muzzle's out at exactly the same point.
Maybe even closer.
Maybe closer.
Depending on, you know, how you're doing it. So, and if you want an alternative approach to the earphones, I like the bionic hearing. That's a really good point. But, you know, if you want to keep things a little quieter, you can always pop something on the end. Now, I've kind of found with the AR pistol platform, by the time you stick a suppressor on the end, it kind of works out to about the same as a regular AR rifle. So there's your trade-off.
And if you do any training, it's pretty easy to resolve the problem of somebody grabbing the end of your firearm. You go to one knee and then press and repeat as necessary.
You know, Tom, your idea of the suppressor, I agree 100%. It's brilliant. And but I'm wondering, you know, maybe we should push for some legislation as a sort of a home defense suppressor law. You know, in other words,
a little more palatable.
Yeah.
Your political powers.
Yeah. You make it a little easier to buy. Maybe it doesn't cost as much with the tax thing, but maybe a caveat is, you know, you can only use it at the range and at home. You know, you can't transport it around or go hunting with it. I mean, I don't mind. I would take the hit for defining the use a little bit in order to get it more available, you know, to someone.
That's a good point. The PR behind that is really good. The messaging behind that, it can't be more defensive than that.
No.
And don't tell anybody, but you know what I really like about that? It's an incremental step. We could get one win and then we go for the next win, right?
So it is. I think so.
So y'all don't think we're going to be happy with that as the end all. That's step one.
You know, I think you guys definitely have the win as far as shootability and control. And I think for an average homeowner, if there's such a thing, who aren't really willing to devote a fairly significant amount of time to training with a handgun, I tend to agree completely. Taking your environment into play, you know, if you're in a condo in the city, maybe, you know, a rifle isn't most appropriate, but certainly a shotgun loaded with, you know, number four buck or a sporting load. But I think having, like, being more of a generalist though, and having something easily accessible in all three categories probably makes the most sense. As Clint Smith was always fond of saying, handguns are really good. There you go. You know, handguns are really good to fight your way to your rifle.
Exactly.
I think, you know, Brent and I, you and I are all retired cops, and anytime I've ever needed my gun when I was a policeman, and even a few times otherwise, I've needed it right now. I really didn't have time to go hunt for something or go find my rifle or something like that. And I think home defense guns are actually a lot like that. I actually have two readily accessible home defense guns. And one is a Ruger LCP2 380 that I keep in my pocket all the time. Everywhere I go, no matter what I'm doing, it's always there in my pocket. And so, you know, that handles that have a gun problem if you're in a gunfight. And that's what a handgun does next to your bed at night. So, but gosh, there's a lot more than just the guns, right? I mean, you guys weighed in on that. I think the gun is sort of the final option. I think there's some other things people need to think about.
Can we talk about lights for a minute?
That's where I was going. So take it, Tom.
I know for a fact. I don't even have to ask. I'll bet $1,000 trillion that both of you guys have one of these on your nightstand or something like it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many on the nightstand?
Not connected to a gun, right?
Not connected. Yeah. Because what is it? One is none and two is one. One is
none.
Yeah. You know?
Well, and you know, there's lots of home emergency types. There's fire. There's a tree falling on your house. There's a coyote in the yard. Who knows? You know, this is a good way to find out what's going on without pointing a weapon at somebody or something that's still unknown.
I tell a story and when I've taught before, and it really drives it home. You also really need a light on your weapon, and all of ours do. Mm. And I have a good example of that. Years ago, I was living out in the country and my son was in high school, and I heard some noise one night, and you know, the prudent thing would be to call the police. Well, I was the police. So of course I grabbed my trusty shotgun and away I go. I went out the front door after kind of checking the area and trying to figure out what it was. And I got outside and I'm stealthily checking my property, and I heard a noise and I immediately spin, light up my light, challenge the person. It was my son. Turns out that some of his friends were toilet papering in the neighborhood, and he knew that. And he had come out the back door because he was afraid I was going to, you know, shoot, kill, maim, or whatever his friends, but he didn't bother to tell me. So when I went around the garage, I had my light on, and of course I wasn't on target, so I didn't have my finger on the trigger, but still, pointing a weapon at your family member is not a good day. But I'm just so happy that I chose to do what you should do and have a light on your weapon, because that's what's really going to save you from having a tragedy. So that's kind of a downer, but it's a direct practical application that I lived, and to this day I've still got goosebumps over it.
I noticed you had one on your shotgun, and it looked like Roy had one on the handgun you held up on that Smith & Wesson.
Yep. Yeah, and you're right.
I do too. There's one on the AR and the Beretta that I held up.
Well, you know, I'm rarely more than an arm's distance away from another flashlight, not counting the one you have in your pocket. Mm-hmm. You know, I would like, speaking of flashlights, though, is that with modern battery technology, with the lithium rechargeable batteries, I think modern tactical flashlights have finally overcome a problem that used to exist in the old days, which was when I was a policeman, it was all NICAD batteries, I guess.
Yeah.
And it just seemed invariably when you needed your light, it didn't work. Yeah. And so I was a strong proponent of having at least my backup light have real batteries in it. And even though the modern lithium ones really seem to be pretty effective and they hold their charge for a long time, I still keep my secondary light next to my bed is a high intensity flashlight loaded with CR123 batteries.
Yeah.
And because you just know the darn thing's probably going to work when you pick it up. May I add one more thing too, which is as soon as the virus fiasco is over here and you're allowed to go shopping again, is I want everyone who's listening or watching to this to go to Home Depot or Lowe's and buy the biggest, nastiest fire extinguisher they can find.
And
bring that home and sit it next to your bed. Because as Tom said, the real emergency that's going to happen here is probably a home fire or something like that. And so if you have a big fire extinguisher next to your bed, then you can fight your way out of the fire. You can rescue your family. And not one of those little teeny tiny ones. I mean something big honking, you know, nasty commercial size fire extinguisher. Plus, you can always squirt some bad guy with it, which would really be an uncomfortable position.
Well, it's like turbo pepper spray, right?
Yeah, turbo pepper spray. Yeah.
Although I have to challenge you on that. I don't see why you would possibly need a fire extinguisher. Can't you just call the fire department?
Well, there's that. And you're exactly right.
Let me get my tongue out of my cheek. Hang on. It's stuck.
Like calling the policeman. Yeah.
I know where Roy lives, and your response time would be measured in what? Hours? Decades? Yeah.
No, it'd be measured in where the hell are you?
Another factor to think about too is I don't know what you sleep in and I don't want to know. But if you're like many of us and you just sleep in pajama bottoms or underwear or and you're all together, if you have to get up and go check something, have you got a way to carry your spare flashlight, your spare magazine, your cell phone? Probably not. I'm sure Tom could come up with some ways of doing that if you're not wearing anything, but a part of my ensemble is I have a small over the shoulder bag that regardless of what I've got on, it sits next
like
to the
man purse,
purse, a small one that I can just throw over. It's actually, I hate to say this, it's a fanny pack. It's a small fanny pack, but you can loop it right over your neck and you've got reloads. You got a spare flashlight. If you want to throw your cell phone in there, it's good to go. So
that's a wonderful idea. I actually designed something some years ago, which was put in production for a little while. But hopefully this will get people to think about it. And all it was just a simple bag that you put around your neck. And there was a magazine pouch. There was a pouch for your cell phone. And there was a flashlight pouch. And then on the back, I had him put a pouch for a quick clot, for first aid. And it was interesting. I talked to a guy who was a back from combat, and he said, y'all need to put a bottle of water in there too, because you get really thirsty. And I thought, you know, he's right.
Yep. That's absolutely true. You have that massive adrenaline dump, and after things are kind of calm, you're like, I really need a glass of water.
It's true. Well, let's see. Are we missing anything here? I think training. I mean, you know, it goes without saying, but let's say it anyway. And that even if it's watching videos that on a FMG YouTube channel, we have a lot of videos about
a lot
basic firearm safety training, how to use your sights, trigger control, some basic tactic stuff. But that's only barely scratching the top of it. If you're someone who doesn't really train, remember that old saying that if you don't train, when something happens, you'll revert to your training, which is nothing.
Nothing.
And so you won't know how to affect, you know, how to be effective.
And, you know, I just thought of something that it doesn't fall in the whole tactical realm and guns, but, you know, something that is real critical to me. My bedroom is right off the front door. I have an alarm. It's one of these cheap $10 motion sensors that I mount on our porch facing the doorway so that in the middle of the night, if somebody comes to my door and would be intent on trying to get in, I give at least a few seconds of a really ear-splitting warning. So
let's go on record, how, and let's do a follow-up to this one, and let's talk about some specific things people could do to harden their target. You know, because I think in a perfect world, not having them get inside so you need to use your gun is, of course,
a lot better.
Yep. And I spent a segment of my police career addressing neighborhood watch groups about, you know, how do you harden your target? What do you do around your house? Yep. And your tip about the alarm is great. I put one of those Ring doorbell things up a while ago. They're a couple $100. They hook up to your Wi-Fi. This one's battery controlled. It lasts for weeks. And I have to say, it's just unbelievable how convenient. If anybody comes to your door, your phone tells you. I mean, what a security thing. What a first line of defense. So,
and you can see it.
And you can see who's there and talk to them. You know, yeah, I've answered my door when I've been hundreds of miles away, and I think it's great. So,
Roy, I'll give you a slow pitch as one retired cop to another. Everybody hardens their door and, you know, puts all kinds of stuff on it. What's the part of the door that breaks when somebody puts a shoulder or foot into it? It's the jam.
You're exactly right. Yep. That's funny you should say that, because I actually have used my advanced metalworking skills, and I've got a 1-inch wide by 1/4-inch thick, about 12-inch long piece of strap steel that I've lag screwed on the inside edge of the door jamb. Because of that.
Yeah. Yep. I've got all, you can buy them, but if you've got the machining skills like Roy, just reinforce the strike and make sure, if you look, most of them are screws about that long and they go into soft pine.
Brass screws.
Yeah.
Let's follow up though with something and let's cover some specifics, but easy things that people can actually do. Yeah.
Like cutting their shrubs back.
Yeah. Putting a few lights in. You bet.
And of course, man's best friend, an animal, whether that be a dog, a Komodo dragon, whatever you choose, as long as it lets you know. And actually, a big dog is more reassuring, but you know what the best watchdogs are? Those little cotton ball looking yap yap dogs,
because they noisy. Bark
at everything. how did we go from shotguns to yap yap dogs?
There's your motion sensor Pekingese.
That's right. Well, I think we beat this into the ground here, guys. Have we?
I would agree. Thanks for listening to this quick hit episode of the Guns Magazine podcast. If you have comments or questions, please send me an email. That's editor@gunsmagazine.com. Or you can reach Tom and Roy at editor@AmericanHandgunner.com. Remember, you can listen to us at gunsmagazine.com in the podcast tab, or subscribe to us at your favorite podcast directory. While you're at it, also don't forget to check out American Handgunner at AmericanHandgunner.com. Whatever you do, please tell all your friends, even the liberals. On behalf of editor Tom McHale and Roy Huntington, I'm guns editor Brent Wheat. Now be safe, and when you can, get out there and get shooting.
Bye-bye.